Jacksonville, Florida, all the way from Maine, North Carolina. Thank you. Other people from Florida, Peachtree City, Puerto Rico. We have people from all over the country. I would say, ooh, U.S. Virgin Island, Texas, Miami, Mobile, Alabama. Welcome to you all. Hopefully you could see my screen there. Welcome again. Thanks for joining us. My name is Shirley Merlo. I am the Deputy Director for NOAA's Hurricane Research Division, which is part of the Atlantic Oceanographic and Meteorological Laboratory. I'm joined by my co-host here, Jamie Rome. He is the storm surge specialist. He's part of the storm surge specialist unit. He's the lead of that unit, which is part of the National Hurricane Center. This webinar is brought to you by the National Hurricane Center and the NOAA's Southeast and Caribbean Regional Collaboration Team, which is one of 8 regional collaboration teams across the country. This webinar is being recorded, and as a courtesy to our presenters, all of you attendees are muted. If you have a question, please use the chat box, the question box in on your right-hand part of the screen, and you know, feel free to ask your questions right away. We'll try to get to as many as we can during this hour that we have together. Due to the high volume of attendees, some of the slides may be a little bit delayed, so please be patient with us as we get through that. Just want to point you to our website where we have all of our webinars that are going to be shared. This is number 3 of our series. Last week we did one in Espanol, and the previous one, which kicked off our series, was a year in review of last year. So just to show you a quick rundown of some of the topics that we're covering this year, we're talking about what happened last year. We also talked, this is what's coming up in next week in the following seminars. So stay tuned for this one and as well as the other ones that we're gonna share with you throughout this series. All right, so I wanna kick it off to my co-host, Jamie Rome. Go ahead and please introduce our speakers for today.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Shirley. My name is Jamie Rome. As she said earlier, I lead the Storm Surge Unit in the National Hurricane Center. We have a pretty cool setup for you today. I don't think we've ever really organized anything quite like this. And it kind of stemmed from the insatiable appetite and interest following Laura in how much surge occurred following Laura and how we go about determining what the peak storm surge was after an event for any event. And we don't, there's just not enough of what we call in situ observations or in place observations to properly measure and analyze storm surge. So we have to use some pretty cool forensics. And the setup today is designed to help you understand how we perform that type of post-analysis. So we will start first with Jeff Lindner and Jeff Evans. Jeff Lindner is a meteorologist with the Harris County Flood Control District, and Jeff Evans is the meteorologist in charge of our Houston-Galveston Weather Service forecast office. So Jeff and Jeff, when you guys are ready, please take it away.
All right, Jamie, can you see my screen there properly?
Yep,
we got the right monitor up. All right, good, thanks. I appreciate the opportunity here. Just want to talk a little bit. Jeff Lindner and I have worked together and collaborated on a lot of different things, Harris County's in the Houston area there. But this was last year was a fairly unique setup where we worked with Harris County Flood Control and the National Weather Service as a team to go out and near real time to try to verify the surge values and surge heights, what we were dealing with last year with a number of pretty much a record number of storms in the Gulf of Mexico. Jeff, I might just turn it over to you for the first few slides there, and once we get into some examples, I'll take it over from there if you want.
Okay, yeah, absolutely. So this is Jeff Lindner again with Harris County. And like Evan said, we worked last year with multiple storms. I actually did this back in 2018 with Hurricane Michael in the Florida Panhandle and really all the way back to Ike in 2008 over here in Harris County and on Bolivar. But we came up kind of with this goal of what it is that we're out there trying to do and what it is we're trying to find. And, you know, the most important thing is accurate high water marks from the storm surge and both determining the height, how high the water got vertically, and also the inland extent, how far inland the seawater penetrated. And we do that in both ways, of above ground level and also reference to datum, in this case, NAV88. And the reason for all this is to provide the National Hurricane Center and the local weather forecast office the information of what actually happened out there. A lot of times the observations and the NOAA sites will fail during the storm, or you're not going to see the maximum surge at those locations at the tide sites. And so you can see some different values of what you can see in real time on the web versus what actually happened out there when you go out there and take a look. Next slide. So these are some of the reasons why we were collecting the high water marks, obviously to determine those elevations between the tide gauge sites, and then what type of storm this was based on a frequency. Was this a 10-year return frequency, or 50-year, or 100-year? We can also compare then the levels that we get with this particular storm with previous storms for comparison purpose. And it also helps in calibrating some of the models that are used to predict storm surge in the future. So we can have all this to improve the services, to improve the warnings, and to improve the life safety aspect of the storm surge forecast for the future. Next slide. And so when we're out there collecting high water marks, there's several different things to look at. It's just not going and finding a water line. You have different aspects of water marks. One is a still water mark. That's the one we try to find most of the times. And then you get into the situation with wave and wave run up and surge run up and all these different types of marks that you can have out there. And you can see multiple marks, different marks at the same exact location. And so trying to find a watermark at times can be difficult. And you can see in some of the pictures, the stuff you have to get into and deal with. And it's important to not always utilize the first mark you come up with and assume that's the high watermark. It's good to examine the entire area, look in multiple rooms, look in multiple locations at a site. And to be honest with you, as we dealt with some with Laura and Delta, it can be frustrating. It can be difficult. And there's times where it can take 30 minutes or an hour to find a high watermark at a certain location. And so there's a lot of effort and a lot of work that goes into this. Go ahead, Jeff. And so the various marks that you can look for, you can see here in the picture there, that's a pretty decent vegetative line mark on a chain link fence. Chain link fences are great for collecting debris, so you usually get some pretty decent marks. You got to be careful with vegetation. When the storm surge comes in, the water comes in, the waves come in, it's going to lay down that vegetation. And then over time, by the time you get out there, that vegetation is going to return vertically in its natural position. And so you have to be careful. That can sometimes you can misinterpret some of the marks when it comes to vegetation. Seed lines inside structures, especially in cabinets and in bathrooms, things like that, enclosed locations inside, things that don't move with the storm surge. So you're not talking about vehicles and things like that that can float and move. But in structures that are attached to the ground, that's where you find some really, really good marks. And most of the time, those are going to be still water marks. You have to be careful with mud lines. A mud line tends to be left where the water sits for a little bit of time, so it holds steady. So at times, the water can actually get higher than the mud line. And then when the water comes back down, it can stay stationary for a little bit and leave a mud line. So you have to be careful with mud lines. And there's various places that you can look for high water marks. Again, inside structures, protected areas are your best location to find some of these marks. It's interesting, power poles is listed on there. I don't think I've ever found a really good high water mark on a power pole. They just don't tend to catch a lot of debris on them. Occasionally, you'll find a small seed line sometimes near the base of them, but I've never really found a really good high water mark or debris line on a power pole. Next slide, Jeff. And concrete, you can see here that concrete pole on the corner is completely clear versus what you see there on the chain link fence. And so any type of surfaces like concrete and brick, they tend to sometimes not catch a lot of the debris, interestingly. Go ahead.
All right. I think I'll steer here for a few slides there. One of the problems that we deal with in particular now with the messaging on surge going to above ground level is what is above ground level? It's easier to understand if you have a structure or something that you can measure vertically above what's a representative ground level. But here's some examples from Hurricane Hanna last July, where we were dealing with trying to come up with above ground level on an open beach or right along an interstate off-ramp here, like we show here. It's really tricky. So what we ended up doing, and the big advantage of having this multi-agency effort here, is that the Harris County Flood Control District can actually bring satellite-fed GPS units into the field with us, so we can get real-time NABD 88 readings off the GPS. So, you know, you can see where you have on the slide that when you see that debris line, obviously right where that debris line settled, that was zero AGL. That's right where the water stopped there, but that's not representative for what has really occurred at that location. And the other issue is that 3 feet or greater is a verification of the surge warning. So you really like to try to get what you can there, you know, the best estimate you can on AGL. So what we would do here is we would shoot the seed line, which was pretty well defined, the debris line, and then we would go down to the water and find the best estimate of the mean high water mark. That's the level where places typically will go under during high tide. So a lot of times you could see where the grass starts growing, where the moss lines are on the rocks are, things of that nature. We would measure that, and then we would take the difference in using that mean high water as a kind of our ground level, and what was above that, we'd find a difference. So both of these locations here, we ended up about 2 to 2.5 feet above ground level. But, you know, this would not be, we wouldn't be able to go get these readings if we did not have that GPS in the field that that Harris County brought with us. Otherwise, you know, we would have to just kind of mark these and maybe try to make a guess the best we can. Another problem we dealt with, particular with Laura, is when you have a surge, a significant surge, especially as it goes inland, what is above ground level? Most of the houses, I'd say about 50-50 perhaps, were on stilts that you would typically see right along the coastline. But in this part of Louisiana, there were a significant number, about another half, that were built up on mounded earth. You know, this is a location that dealt with a significant surge from Rita in 2005, Ike in 2008, Carla and Audrey back in the 60s. So this is an area that has dealt with a lot of significant surge. So a lot of these structures were built up on maybe 6 to 8 feet of mounded earth above what would be a representative ground level. So going up into a structure and finding, like this example here, you know, finding a watermark that's say 4 feet above the slab, you know, that's not representative of 4 feet above ground level, because the ground level is actually, that house is lifted 6 to 8 feet. So we would generally would use the road surface, or just in this case where that blue arrow is, the surrounding countryside where we were. So we would take a measurement there. In this case here on the case on the right, the water did not enter that structure. You could see the debris line on the back edge of that home. So we took that measurement. We went down to the level ground level, took a measurement. Once again, would take the difference. So certainly, you know, figuring that out is much more complicated in the field when you're having to try to interpret exactly what's representative and what's not. This is an interesting case here. As you can see, we were actually on the road level where this picture was taken. So this is a good example of how high some of these homes were built up above the kind of representative ground level. But when we came up to this structure, there was a pretty well-defined debris line in the yard. And from the street here, it looks like there was quite a bit of wind damage at this home. So we went up, and that debris line was spray painted by some prior agency as a high water mark at this location. We went up and dug a little bit more, and as soon as we turned the corner of this house, we realized this entire structure was significantly impacted by storm surge. I've got some other pictures of what the inside of this house looked like further on in the presentation, but we couldn't even really get into. We had to hunt around for a representative wall that was still standing. We did find this wall here. This was a bedroom wall right behind that garage. The only way to access it was through a broken window. Which we kind of, I was voted to crawl into and try to get a measurement there against that wall there. So the actual high water mark at this location, we estimate about 8.7 feet AGL. And again, this is well inland near Creole, Louisiana. Another one, Jeff, this is one of your slides here, if you want to take this one, just being wary of the waves.
Yeah, this was a house at Grand Chenier where we actually had a very nice still water mark inside, and then we wanted to get a wave mark outside for comparison. The way, you know, obviously the still water mark there in the bathroom is excellent. That's a really good mark. It's a little bit more subjective when you start dealing with the waves. Clearly, the water was very deep at this location, 20 feet high or so, and well into the trees here. And so you can see there was some debris on that limb there, which we marked up as a wave mark. There wasn't any debris higher than that we could tell in the tree. So obviously this is probably a little bit subjective, but I think always when you're dealing with wave, you're going to be subjective. And that's one thing to keep in mind with high water marks is, you know, unless it's a really good still water mark like you see there in the bathroom, there's going to be some subjectivity to it, and you could be off, you know, plus or minus 6 inches or so with the actual, what the actual water level was, especially when you're dealing with wave. You can really, you know, have some difficulty sometimes with the waves. And you can see in the landscape here, when you're just looking back in the back, there's not a whole lot there to for high water marks on. You can see it's a lot of marshland, a lot of trees that were bent over and completely submerged. And so it's really good to try to find the structures. Go ahead, Jeff.
And I was going to say, you can look like a slab there. So a lot of times these locations, the structure didn't survive the surge. So there's no way you can get a mark on some of those as well. So on this one, we're just going to talk about kind of going back to the waves, is understanding the exposure of the site as well. So both of these cases here were from Hurricane Hannah. We got a site there off Matagorda Bay, just south of Port Lavaca, where you could see a well-defined debris line from Hannah's surge above a little bit of a seawall. And then the same thing within within Corpus Christi Bay there, in Corpus Christi, another well-defined a debris line above the seawall there. So we kind of did the same thing as far as we would shoot the debris line. We would try to find the moss line, so to speak, to get an estimate of the mean high water. To take a difference. But both of these locations were exposure to the north-northeast. So for a southward landfall like we dealt with at these locations, it's good to have a meteorologist on the team that knows the exposure, where the winds and the waves would have been coming from. But another example of how you have to be really careful when you get the waves and understanding that, you know, with the wave run up and just actual waves themselves, you're going to get much higher values than you would from the actual still water surge. I think this this Corpus Christi Bay site, we had over 10 feet of a wave mark in there, but most of the representative still water surge in location was about half of that. Jeff, I'll pass this back to you, dealing with some of the logistical challenges sometimes of just getting to the sites.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, we were actually pretty fortunate with Laura that most of the roadway network was not damaged. It was a totally different situation in the Florida Panhandle with Hurricane Michael back in 2018. And most of these images here are from Hurricane Michael, where you had significant infrastructure damage to the roadways. You just couldn't get to some areas in those locations. And so there's kind of a sweet spot between getting into an area too quickly when you still have search and rescue operations ongoing, and then waiting too long and people start cleaning up and those high water marks start disappearing. So go ahead, Jeff. The other thing to keep in mind as I'm talking here is traffic. You're dealing also with a location where there is no power, there is no traffic signals. And in a lot of cases, you have very significant traffic, especially in the more urban areas when you pass through towns or stuff like that. When you're out in kind of the rural open areas, it's not as big of a deal. One of our biggest challenges we had during Laura was actually there's a ferry between Cameron and Holly Beach south of Lake Charles, and that ferry was completely knocked out. The landings were destroyed. And so to get to the other side of the channel, which is probably the size of a football field or so, we had to drive about 60 miles all the way back up to I-10 and then come back south on the west side of Calcasieu Lake. And so that type of stuff can really make for a long day. Most of your days when you're doing this are 12 to 14 hours in the heat with absolutely no services. And so you have to take everything with you, food, water, everything, because there's absolutely nothing down in these areas. It's a complete disaster area. And you can see here with some of the pictures, I think this is your stuff, Jeff.
Yeah, I was just going to say, as the slide says, and getting to what Jeff was saying, there are a lot of complexities that you deal with. You have to deal with the unexpected. In a longer talk, Jeff has a slide here. After three long days of serving for Laura, he ended up locking his keys in the truck, trying to get gas. It's certain things you deal with. So this is that house that we had the high water mark in the yard that was a faulty marking. That was what the inside of the house looked like when we went up and looked at it. And, how do you get it to high? How do you get in there to get a high water mark? You know, we were very fortunate. You could see me crawling through that window that we actually could find a mark and that I was able to get in there very carefully, trying not to stab my back with the glass there. You can see Jeff standing in almost knee-deep mud and murk. I think that was from Delta from this year getting a high water mark. And then you can see the alligator there we had. That was a surprise visitor during a HANA survey around Matagorda Bay. We looked up and there he was. So certain things that you're going to deal with when you get out and do these surveys and some of the complexities. So it's definitely a lot of hot and hard work. I just want to briefly touch on Laura here as we get into some of the concluding slides. So this was the highest measured search location from Laura. We came upon this house. So you can see on the left, there were stairs to nowhere. The porch was kind of wiped out along the front side of the house. You can see Jeff Lindner standing on the backside. To access this location, I kind of lifted myself up that back porch. There was a window that was still broken. I was able to get in. I was walking around inside this house, looking in cabinets, and couldn't find a high water mark for the life of me. But it was several inches of mud and reeds. It was really really nasty in there. I finally realized there was a second story. Went to the stairwell and realized pretty quickly there was mud and reeds all the way up into the second floor. And I was kind of like, oh my God, this actually. No wonder I can't find a value down here. This whole bottom floor was completely inundated. Got up to the top floor very carefully, trying not to fall in the mud, and came across the bathroom there where I measured up 2.5 feet deep on the second floor. So we did our best in the field at the time. We ended up saving this location. The USGS came out, I think, the next week, was able to spend a little bit more time, and ended up measuring 17.1 feet. Above ground level using the highway there in front of the structure at the ground level. So that was actually the highest measured value, although looking at the hindcast simulations, Jamie's group, it looks like they may have been up to about 18 feet peak still water surge from Laura. Go ahead, Jeff, you want to take this?
Yeah, just like we kind of talked about through all of this, some of the stuff, when you get in there is really dependent on the intensity of the storm. For Michael, it was about a week and a half, and it's really good also to go in with the local National Weather Service. And Michael, we were with the Tallahassee folks, and then Laura, well, with Laura, it was myself and Jeff Evans. And then for Delta, we were with a person from Lake Charles. And it's really good to have that local knowledge, the local understanding of the hydrology in the area. And also those personal relationships and the skills and techniques that you need to deal with finding the high water mark and the equipment. So, sometimes when you're out there dealing with technology, not everything's going to work, especially in locations where cell phone coverage is not good on a normal day versus after, a major hurricane has passed through. Logistical challenges, hotels, you're not going to be able to stay exactly where the storm hit. You're not going to want to stay there, so you're going to have to stay out of the impact zone where you can get gas, you can have hotels and power and food and all that type of stuff. And every day you're going to have to drive into that impact zone and conduct the business. And so, as we talked about the roads and all of that, you will run across residents that are there cleaning up. We had a lot more interaction with folks in Michael than we did with Laura. There just really wasn't a lot of folks down on the coast after Laura. It was virtually completely deserted still down on coastal Louisiana. I think some folks had come back and checked the location and then left again. And the few we did talk to said that they have a lot of family in the region. And so they were staying with that and kind of driving down during the day to do whatever they needed to do. But you will have residents asking you for, phone numbers. How can I get help? How can I reach FEMA? And a lot of times we don't have those answers. We don't know, what the local emergency managers or the local officials are saying, because we're not in that realm when we're down there doing this stuff. And so just be prepared for that. And there's going to be some emotion involved when it also, when you come up on people. There was particularly this one house where the insurance adjuster was at, and Laura, and they were talking to the folks when we pulled up, and it was just this complete daze of, you know, just of what had happened. And, you know, these people are wandering through their house, and they were completely okay with it, but you could just tell on their face that they were just completely dazed by the devastation that had occurred. And so, and of course, you know, when you're marking double events, so like Laura, and then a couple weeks, 6 weeks later, you had Delta strike virtually the same area there in Louisiana, you're still going to have watermarks around from Laura. And so it's really good to send at least the same people or similar people to the area, because what we did with Delta is we actually marked a lot of the same points we did with Laura, because we knew exactly the high watermark we took with Laura, both for a comparison purpose, but also to make sure that we were not marking Laura's high watermarks. And so you got to be careful of that if you get into a situation where you have back-to-back storms.
All right, thanks, Jeff. Yeah, I'll just close it out here. No, we're running out of time. You know, the Coastal Act is coming in 2023. So we're hoping and thinking that what we were able to do last year might become a bit of a model as far as getting out there and accurately getting these measurements within a week or two after the storm. And if you think back to Laura, you know, after Laura, since Lake Charles kind of missed the worst of the surge, there was a lot out there that the surge forecast was overdone, and that the catastrophic, you know, an unsurvivable surge did not occur. It really wasn't until we could get out there to change that narrative and tell these people's story that it actually did occur. So it is important to get out there fairly quickly after the storm and get as accurate a measurements as you can, because as Jeff alluded to early on, that you know, a lot of the highest surges are going to miss the observation platforms that are available out there. So most of this is going to be field work and grunt work. So look, going forward, hopefully this, you know, we'll see more and more teams like this right after the storm. Probably the Hurricane Center Surge Unit will have a large role in structuring that and navigating that. And when we were in the field, we were working with Jamie quite a bit and trying to vector us into to locations that had the highest surge. So that's pretty much all I had. It's just interesting closing slide. This church completely got crushed by Laura's surge, and you can see a slide there where they actually had a statue for Carl and Audrey. So you know, these folks had dealt with this many times over. Jamie?
Hey, thanks, Jeff. Well, you got tons of questions here. I'll try to answer as many as I could. A lot of the questions speak to the complexities of entering the field. So I think this is probably a good chance to remind people that we're not encouraging ordinary citizens to go out after a storm and collect this information. Both Jeff Lindner and Jeff Evans are you know, governmental in nature, and we have preset agreements with them to cover this work. They also have the extra advantage of working with local law enforcement type of, you know, local authorities, so that, you know, their protection during the event, and if they need anything, you know, we've got all those logistics handled. There were a lot of questions about how do we handle entering properties if the resident is not there, and you know, sometimes that's just working with local authorities. Again, we don't want to encourage people to just start wandering around in the aftermath of the hurricane, not only for the sensitivity of the residents impacted. I mean, they've just gone through a horrendous event, but also just safety. I mean, the images Jeff showed you there are extreme safety considerations that must be taken into account before entering.
And
that,
and Jamie, there, you know, when you're out there, you know, you may get confronted by someone who's a homeowner or relative of a homeowner. And you know, being with the National Weather Service, and once we could explain what we were doing, why we were there, certainly you could alleviate a lot of that. You really would not want to be wandering around somebody's property after a storm if you really didn't have an official reason for being there. Obviously, none of us would want that in our homes either.
Right. There are a lot of other questions that speak to the next presentation, the next speaker, which is Robbie Berg. He's a hurricane specialist with the National Hurricane Center. For those who don't know, he drew short straws this year and had the difficult task of writing every single storm surge section, the storm surge section of our post-storm reports, which were numerous. And so now he's going to walk you through how that data is synthesized at the National Hurricane Center to come up with a final analysis. So Robbie, it's all yours.
Yeah, thanks, Jamie. You know, so first off, I have to say we're indebted to Jeff and Jeff for the, you know, what they brought to the table this year in gathering these high watermarks, both in their skill in doing it, precision with which they do it, because their data is critical in helping us understand exactly how high the water did get in all of these storms. So as I begin here, I also want to thank obviously Jamie and then also Cody Fritz, Laura Alaka, and William Booth from the Hurricane Center, all within the storm surge unit, because they were also critical in helping gather the data that we used to figure out how high did the water actually get. So just as a recap of what we're actually doing at the Hurricane Center, we do a lot of post-storm analyses. Every storm that occurs in our area of responsibility, we do a post-storm analysis. And obviously for a landfalling storm, where we have storm surge, that becomes a much harder and time-consuming task. But there's several different reasons that we do this. First off, as I just mentioned, we have tropical cyclone reports that we write on every tropical cyclone, both in the Atlantic and in the Eastern Pacific Ocean, where we have responsibility for storms. And we do that because we want to document what the storm actually did. What were the hazards? What were the impacts? How, you know, good or bad were the forecasts? So we need to essentially gather this data so that we can document what actually happened with that storm. That, I think, makes sense. But there are a few other things. Two, we need to verify both the forecasts that we made and the models that we use to make those forecasts. So whether we're making a storm surge warning, putting out a storm surge warning, whether we're making a forecast for peak inundation, or you know, using the slosh model and P-search guidance that comes out of that, we have to get these observations so that we can evaluate how good were those forecasts, how well did that model perform in that particular storm. So that's also critical. Three, we do this post-storm analysis to support recovery immediately after the storm. We have to identify where the hardest hit areas were so that officials, first responders can get into those areas to help support that immediate recovery after the storm. Most of the time, we don't have all the observations we need at that point, so we do rely on some post-storm simulations for that particular purpose. And then fourth, kind of an extension of the recovery, is that a lot of the analyses that we do are used as input for disaster declarations. In other words, to facilitate the disaster declarations for federal assistance in the areas that are hardest hit. So there are several reasons why we do these analyses, and then obviously several reasons why we have to do the most precise analysis we can. So essentially, this was my job in the off season this year, is I had the job of a sleuth, and everybody that works that I work with, to determine how high did the water get. Our charge is to determine how high the water got above normally dry ground, also known as inundation, by reconciling differences among available storm surge data and filling the gaps between them. So the high water marks that Jeff and Jeff talked about are obviously one of the critical pieces of that puzzle, but as you can see in the slide, there's other things that we get, other pieces of data that we also get during and after a storm that have to be fit into one cohesive story about what happened in that storm. Here are the different types of data that come into us. We get tide gauges and other stream gauges that are actually measuring how high the water got. We have pressure sensors from agencies such as the United States Geological Survey. What those do is they measure the pressure that when the water comes up, that water produces a pressure on the sensor. And so based on how much pressure is occurring on that sensor, it can determine how high the water got. High water marks that Jeff and Jeff talked about, I'm not going to go in depth on those because they already did a great job of explaining that. And then we also supplement all of these data types with model simulations. That helps us fill in the gaps. Before I talk about these data types, though, we do have to really quickly mention datums, and this is critically important. So there are two types of datums that we often use when we're looking at data. And a datum, by definition, is essentially just a reference level, that when we have the water from a storm, it's moved up, storm surge has come in, we have to describe that level based on something, based on some reference level, and that is what's called a datum. There are two types of datums. The tidal datums are those that are defined by certain phases of the tide. You may have heard about mean sea level, mean low, low water, mean higher, high water. Those are all different phases of the tide. So we can use that as a reference level. However, there's also the geodetic or orthometric datums, which are reference levels based on an abstract coordinate system which represents the shape of the Earth. Those include NABD88 and NGBD29. There are others as well, depending on where you live. For the main part of the United States, NABD88 is the main geodetic vertical datum. Now, I'm saying this is important because oftentimes you'll get a piece of data saying how high the water got, but I can't tell you how many times we see that number and somebody hasn't told you what that reference level is. And so really that piece of data means absolutely nothing unless you know what reference level it is tied to. So we've been talking about so far in this talk about inundation. And then I think Jeff also mentioned this mean high or high water. So what's the link between those two? Well, inundation is simply just the height of water above normally dry ground. So if I'm walking along the street around my house, around the neighborhood, the height of the water or inundation is essentially how high did the water get up my leg? Okay? It's not tied to any of these other datums per se. It's just based on the ground I'm standing on, how high up my leg or up my body did the water get? That's inundation, above ground level. Now, a lot of the data we get aren't actually put in places where we're walking around the street. Okay? We know we have tide gauges, for example, but those tide gauges happen to be out in the middle of the bay or the ocean. So we're not measuring necessarily above ground with those particular measurement types. So what we've done is we're using this one particular tidal datum, mean high or high water, as a good reference level at which anything above that is when inundation can begin to occur. And we've actually worked with the National Ocean Service in determining this, where they have said that the best approximation for the threshold at which inundation can begin to occur is mean high or high water. So for example, if you look down here in the lower right, we have a vertical kind of cross section of a coast where you can see that obviously the tide goes up, it goes down. And based on how we average, let's say average the highest tides, we get that mean high or high water. If we average the lowest tides, we get mean low or low water. So we know that the tide range is between those two datums. If the water gets above that mean high or high water line, then we know that that land there isn't normally flooded. Even on the highest tides, it's not normally flooded. So if the water from surge got up above that level, now we say inundation has occurred. And another way to look at it here is with this cross section of this kind of subtidal, intertidal, supertidal area here, where this intertidal area is the area that gets flooded at high tide, but then it's exposed at low tide. But if the storm comes and pushes the water above that mean high or high water line, now we're starting to flood parts of the beach and then up in the upland areas where the trees are located that aren't normally wet. That's again what we call inundation. So that's why we're using that tidal datum when we look at things like tide gauge observations, because it does give us a very good representation of the type of inundation that may be occurring in the area. So here you go, is the tide gauges. This happens to be the tide gauge from the National Ocean Service at Calcasieu Pass, Louisiana. What you're actually looking at is the different datums associated with that tide gauge. So in other words, here's the mean high or high water line here at the top. Here's mean sea level. What it's telling you is that mean sea level at that gauge happens to be 0.69 feet below the mean high high water line. The mean low low water line happens to be 1.81 feet below the mean high high water line. So in other words, I can look at the height of the water at Calcasieu Pass. I can actually choose the datum, but if I'm not aware of which datum I'm using, then the number I throw out there is not going to make any sense. So for Calcasieu Pass during Laura, that gauge actually measured 11 feet above mean low low water, but 9.19 feet above mean high high water. And again, that's the level that we use as a proxy for inundation. So based on that tide gauge alone, we can say that nearby, in the adjacent area, the highest inundation near Calcasieu Pass was likely about 9 feet. So in other words, if I was standing right at the high tide line, it was about 9 feet of inundation at that location, which would have been obviously over all of our heads. So that's how we use tide gauges. Again, you can select the datum that you want to look at. For our purposes, we're using this mean high high water datum to estimate how much inundation is occurring in the vicinity of the gauge. Pressure sensors. Again, these mainly come from the United States Geological Survey. One thing I'll note about these is that the water level is usually above NABD88. Okay, so it's the geodetic datum, not the tidal datum. Now, there are lots of considerations you have to use or think about when you're looking at the pressure sensor data. First off, is it located within the intertidal zone? Or is it located on normally dry ground? And that actually makes the difference when you're looking at the data to know what you're looking at. I think Jeff had mentioned it earlier, is that for some of those high water marks that are well inland, there is no mean high water datum to tie it to because it's above tide, the usual tide fluctuations. So you really have to know where that sensor is located to know what type of conversions you can do to it to get it to give you an above ground level type of look at it. So we really have to be concerned about where it's located. Is the data filtering waves? As Jeff talked about with high water marks, waves can be a big issue. So you have to be aware of whether or not the gauge or the sensor is actually taking waves into account or if they're being filtered. And then, as I already mentioned, knowing which datum was used. This happens to be the sensor that was deployed ahead of Hurricane Laura in the Rockefeller National Wildlife Refuge. This was a little bit further inland. It's not right at the immediate coast. So the wave action with this particular sensor was quite low. So you can see that the water trace here in blue went spiked up, and then it came back down as the surge went back out. There's not a whole lot of wiggles along there because the wave action was pretty light in that particular area. That particular gauge or the sensor, it was 10.05 feet NAV88, and when we did a conversion, we got roughly 9 feet mean high water. So at that location, we estimated about 9 feet of inundation. Here's a similar gauge that was deployed during Hurricane Michael. This is at Mexico Beach. You can see that the location of this gauge is different. This was located on the pier in Mexico Beach, so it was obviously within the intertidal zone. Okay, the water would come up. And what happened in Michael, there was a lot of wave activity on that open coast with the exposure. And you can see that here with the trace. You can see lots of ups and downs. In fact, there's this one quick little spike there in the water level, and that's due to wave action. So sometimes what happens is this data is out there publicly and somebody will see, if you look here, it says 20.60. First off, there's the datum issue. Second off, that includes the waves, an individual wave. And we cannot include that when we're doing our analysis because it's not representative of the still water level. So what we do is we use the filtering algorithm that's provided by the USGS. And in that case, we use the second number, which is 15.55 feet. NAVD88, it filters out the wave action in that case. And when we do that, we got 14.7 feet mean high water. So based on that, that gauge helped us to estimate that the highest inundation in Michael, in the Mexico Beach area, was about 14 feet from that particular storm. So again, you had to make sure the datum was right and you had to filter out the wave activity because it's not representative of the actual surge. Okay, high water marks. I'm really not going to go in depth about this because the two Jeffs already talked about that. But one thing that I did want to mention is that we have to be aware of whether or not it's a vertical type of high water mark, such as a mud, foam stain, or seed line. They showed this one in Laura, the bathtub. That tells you how high the water got versus the debris lines, which are horizontal. They tell you how far inland the water penetrated. So as Jeff explained, if I go right to that debris line and I say, how high was it above ground level? It's zero, because at that location, the water wouldn't have come up my pant leg. So there's other methods we have to use to estimate inundation closer to the ocean when we're looking at debris line measurements. Also, as they mentioned, be aware of still water versus high water marks that are influenced by waves and currents. Our preference is obviously we want ones on the left because they're still, they're not influenced by those waves and currents. And so if they're inside structures, we get a nice still water line that we can do a measurement. Often what can happen with the high water marks with waves and currents, as Jeff explained, is that these debris snags can get caught on these structures like the chain link fence, and it may not be actually representative of how high the water got. So we do have to be cautious of the quality of those high water marks. So lots of different data that we're looking at after a storm. And again, because we have to make sure they're all on the same datum so we can compare apples to apples, one thing that we do is we use this tool from NOAA called the V-Datum Conversion Tool. And this helps us to convert data from one datum to another within applicable areas. There are some areas along the coast where we can't apply these conversions, but there are some areas where we are able to do this. It takes a little bit of skill to know how to use this because you have to be able to know how to convert between the specific datums. And then there's also horizontal datums we have to be worried about, making sure that that's set correctly as well when we're doing the conversion. So again, it takes a little bit of skill to know exactly what you're doing, but this tool is critical for us to make sure that we can get everything on a similar baseline. So after we look at all the data, we do all the conversions, then we put it all together. So what you're looking at here is all the different tide observations, stream gauge observations, high water marks, and pressure sensor data that we got from Hurricane Laura in southwestern Louisiana. And they've all been converted to either above ground level or a mean high or high water, which is that proxy for above ground level. And now you can see that patterns have emerged, such that here in this, where you see these purple markings, we had inundation of 12 feet or greater. And we kind of go off to the side with the red, orange, yellow, and blue, et cetera. So if I hadn't done those conversions, you would have seen colors kind of speckled all over the map. There wouldn't have been any kind of pattern to what you were looking at. But putting everything on this common baseline really allows us to see where that highest inundation occurred. Now, what you'll notice here is that we only have in-situ observations in some locations. We're not covering all of the area of southwestern Louisiana with actual observations. So what we have to also do is these post-storm simulations, where we take the track of the storm once we know what actually happened, rerun that through the SLOSH model, the storm surge model that the Weather Service uses, so that we can get a better two-dimensional understanding of what may have happened with that storm. These are conducted by the Storm Surge Unit at the Hurricane Center to meet interagency requirements with FEMA, and then we use them to fill in the gaps where there are no in-situ observations. The other thing that the model simulations allow us to do is we can compare the model to the observations we have to see if the model is actually capturing the type of inundation that did occur. If it's off by a few feet, then we can make adjustments to the observations that we're looking at, or adjust the simulation and say, well, maybe because it's not as high as what the model, the observation is showing, we need to decrease some of those simulated inundation levels a little bit. So this helps us fill in the gap. It's not the answer to what actually happened, but it kind of gives us a good first guess of what may have happened. I will say, too, is that these are also critical in helping us to inform the teams, such as Jeff and Jeff, when they go out and look for high water marks. It helps to direct them to those areas where we think the highest inundation may have occurred. So, for example, when they found that house in Laura that had 17.1 feet above ground level, we were able to direct them to the Creole and Grand Chenier areas to look for those types of high water marks. And then knowing that particular level and what the model simulation is showing, we're able to come to a deduction that 18 feet was the highest that occurred anywhere there in southwestern Louisiana. So just to wrap up here, a few things to keep in mind when you're doing a post-analysis. Again, it's a lot of different data. So first off, that the instrument-based observations rarely, and actually I would probably say never, capture peak inundation. And we saw this a lot after Laura, because people were looking at the NOS tide gauge at Calcasieu Pass, which was probably one of the only pieces of measurement around that had real-time observation. And once they saw 9 feet, they said, well, the forecasts were wrong, they were too high. Then a couple days later, we had a stream gauge from the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers at Mermentau River that showed a little bit higher value, but the problem with that particular gauge is it only reported every hour. So we missed the peak between hours. So I think what it shows you is that we have to do this kind of this post-analysis after the storm, getting all these pieces of data, understanding their biases, understanding what they're really telling you, to come up with a full picture of what the peak inundation occurs. We will, in most cases, never know a day after the storm how high that water really got. Two, datums, and oh yeah, did I forget to tell you, datums. That is critical. If we're not talking about datums or not attaching a datum to the piece of information that we're talking about, then it really doesn't mean anything. We have to make sure we know what datum that piece of information is tied to. Watch out for waves. As best we can, we try to filter them out so that we can actually capture inundation from surge itself. And then also the highest inundation that we analyze may not be where people actually live. So for example, with Lori, even though we got the 17.1 foot at the house, we estimated that 18 feet occurred somewhere else in that area. No one actually lived where that 18 feet occurred. So just because we say the peak is 18 feet, that doesn't mean that anybody in that area actually may have had 18 feet of water at their house or where they work. It's just saying that anywhere in that area, that may have been the highest inundation. So a lot of pieces of data. And again, that's why I just caution you that after a storm, we have to give this process time so that we can actually collect as much of the data as possible to come up with a coherent and accurate story of what happened during the storm. So with that, I'm going to end and I'll turn it back to Shirley and Jamie so that we can finish up by answering everyone's questions.
So if you have any questions for Robbie, type them in there. While we're doing that, Robbie, one thing that kind of jumped out that you can sort of answer is there seem to be a lot of parallels with the more commonly understood challenges with meteorological data, such as the anemometer not at the standard elevation or the averaging time not at the appropriate averaging time. Could you kind of draw a parallel between how this is similar to the meteorological component?
Sure. You know, the parallel here is that, you know, as a hurricane specialist, one of my colleagues' jobs in the hurricane specialist unit is we have to determine how strong a storm is. We have to do that in real time. And we have many different pieces of data to do that. We look at satellite imagery. We look at the data from the Air Force reconnaissance planes. We look at buoys, other land stations. You're getting all this type of data, which oftentimes conflicts. It's not all going to give you the same answer. So we have to know that in which cases is one particular piece of data better than another. For example, if we have the reconnaissance plane in the storm, in most cases, that's going to give us better data than just pure satellite imagery. So, you know, we weigh all of those pieces of data in real time and even after the storm when we're doing the post-analysis to come up with the representative intensity of the storm. This is exactly the same. We're just trying to look at all the data, weigh them, and come up with a representative peak inundation that occurred from the storm as well.
Thank you, Robbie. So that kind of adds to the question we have from one of our participants here. Are these measurements publicly available before the post-storm report is issued?
Good question. So the high watermarks, not generally, because you know, as agencies like Jeff with Harris County Flood Control District, you know, they're going out after the storm and they're trying to find these high watermarks. And so that, again, takes days to a week or more after the storm to actually do that collection. And then that data is often relayed to the Weather Service. And so there are some instances where you may see some of that data out there, but in a lot of cases, until it's all collected, it may not be available publicly. The tide gauge data from the National Ocean Service is always freely available to anybody. You can watch that during an actual storm. But as I mentioned here at the end of this talk, is you have to be watching and making sure you know, what datum are you looking at, and also be aware that it may not be capturing the highest inundation or highest water level where the storm is actually making landfall. The chance that that observation actually hits where the eye wall comes ashore is very, very low. So it really does take looking at all that data afterwards. I think I'll also say the USGS data, they do make some of that data available after the storm, once they've gone out and actually collected it in the days after the storm. But again, as everything else, just with the caveat, understanding, making sure you actually understand what you're looking at before jumping to conclusions on how high the water got.
Thank you for that, Robbie. I'd like to also invite Jeff and Jeff to come back. There's one question that intrigued me. Are there certificates that people, homeowner certificates about elevation height that people can get? Just curious if you know of anything like that.
If you're talking about storm surge, not that I know of. Obviously, there are elevation certificates when it comes to FEMA floodplains and FEMA flood insurance, stuff like that. And those are typically done by a professional surveyor that comes out and surveys the slab of your house and get a stamped certification of your elevation. But as far as storm surge levels go, not to my knowledge.
Thank you for that. Jamie, do you see other questions for our speakers?
Yeah, it's a lot of interest in the upcoming hurricane season. So NOAA hasn't yet released its seasonal forecast. That is, Robbie, that's later this week, I believe. Can't remember the exact date.
Next week.
Yep. Can't remember the exact date.
Stock I put into it.
Yeah. So wait. Stay tuned for the official NOAA seasonal forecast. There was a question about, do we use models to make storm surge predictions? So Robbie, if you want to tackle that one.
Yeah. So obviously the answer there is yes. The model that the National Weather Service uses to make its storm surge predictions is SLOSH, which stands for the Sea, Lake, and Overland Surges from Hurricanes model. But the interesting thing that we do with that model is we don't just run it one time for the storm and see what kind of inundation it gives us. What we actually do is we run that model simulation multiple times where we change the characteristics of the storms. In other words, the hurricane specialist will make an official forecast, but then what the model does, it actually takes that official forecast and it has some storms that are stronger, some that are maybe a little bit bigger, some that maybe move a little bit faster or slower, because all of those characteristics of the storm can alter or modulate how much storm surge occurs. So once we have all those simulations, we can then look at the probabilistic distribution of what kind of storm surge could occur. And based on that, we do produce a product called the potential storm surge flooding map, which is essentially a reasonable worst case scenario or the type of storm surge that you should plan for if the storm was to come in at its worst or its biggest, causing that type of surge where you live. So that is the main model we use. We don't just use the model just in a purely deterministic sense. We do look at it in a probabilistic sense.
So there's a question here for Jeff. And Jeff, a lot of people were amazed of seeing your pictures deep in the mud there, and even your friend, the alligator. Are you guys I'm assuming you guys are taking safety precautions when you're out there? It looked like you weren't wearing safety gear and safety shoes. Just wanted to put that out.
You know, we do. I mean, we do the best we can. I mean, we're not equipped with, hard tip boots or anything and hard hats necessary to go out. And a lot of the surveying, like a storm like Hannah, you're just out there kind of walking along the beach. So you certainly wouldn't want to be in heavy boots and stuff for that. But yeah, you try to be aware of the environment you're going to be going in. You could see with Delta, Jeff had those kind of mud boots on, things of that nature. Mosquitoes, there's lots of different things like that. A lot sunburn, so a lot of sunscreen, a lot of mosquito repellent. Probably the bigger hazards that we dealt with are bugs. Jeff, you want to add anything on that?
No, I think we covered it all. You know, I think it was mentioned earlier that this isn't for everybody, and without the proper credentials. We're in a marked logoed vehicle with credentials and badges with us, and so don't go out there and just go marking high water marks or looking around in some of these areas, because property owners are definitely going to be questioning and have the right in a lot of cases to protect their property. And so we have a reason to be there, credentials to be there. I certainly do not urge people to go out there and try to do this on their own.
Thank you so much, Jeff and Robbie. And again, thanks to my co-hosts. We are nearing the top of the hour here. So unless there's any burning questions that you see, Jamie, otherwise we can close. Jamie?
There's one last question that might be of interest. How do you know the high water mark in a tree versus wind that blew the debris or objects in the tree? That's probably Jeff.
Yeah, I mean, I'd say a lot of the debris, I mean, the wind doesn't loft as much as you would think. A lot of it comes, the water carries more, especially with the denser grasses and stuff. Jeff, I think you're going to speak up on that too.
Yeah, it's a hard question to answer, but you know, and you know when you see it, and when you see the salt marsh wrapped around the tree limbs, that was water. In most of the cases, you can also see the difference between if you look at a certain level of a tree or a bush, you can clearly see where the water was flowing through it and stuff was grabbing, versus above it, nothing. The wind tore everything off, the leaves, everything's gone. There's nothing left. And so you can make that differential. Now, you know, are you 1 or 2 inches? Probably not. You know, you could be plus or minus 6 inches, like I said earlier, but it's better than nothing. And so the wave action, the wave, getting the wave marks and getting the wave run up and everything like that, there is some subjectivity to it. And when you do it long enough, you just kind of learn what to look for and what to see. And in a lot of cases, it's debarking in some cases. There, the wind can maybe debark, but the storm.
Sounds like we lost Jeff Shirley, but we're close to the top of the hour if you want to bring us home.
Yeah, thank you, Jeff. I think you were cut off a little bit there, but you know, I think that's your computer saying time to cut it off. So thank you again, Jeff and Jeff, Robbie. Again, I'm showing my screen now. Hopefully you guys can see it. You see this is our web link for the next round of webinars that we have. So stay tuned for next Monday again. To talk about, what are we talking about? Let me just quickly look here. Let's see. The next one is going to be about marine navigation and forecasting during hurricane events. So stay tuned. Thank you again. And this recording will be available in the days to come. Thank you again, and bye-bye. Have a good day.